One thing I want to say about yesterday that I thought was really special, and that you don't get in a lot of these summer schools, you know, that when you have summer schools that are summer programs that are run by academic people, we're really interested in you know, talking about academic economics, and mostly this means having discussions about methodology, how we know what we know, and indeed, you know, I spoke about methodological issues, as did James, and we're going to be having more methodological talks. So it was very interesting yesterday to have someone who's a policy economist, right? And we should remember that at the end of the day, economics is, and I say this as a theorist, that economics, you know, is an empirical field. And if you're doing theory, you need to think about, you know, how is this going to contribute to what we know, right, about social life and social process, not whether it's kind of a neat mathematical result. And if you're an econometrician, it's the same kind of question. And I think what was particularly interesting to me yesterday was that here we had Scott standing up here and talking about things that policy economists do, and then we had this interchange, you know, among all of the faculty who were here about some of the methods that are being used and things like that, and you can see this dialogue that goes back and forth between policy economists and people with a more academic orientation. And my view, and I don't know whether this is shared by any of you guys, but my view is that there isn't enough of this in the profession. Right? That it seems in my graduate program, I know the people who want to do policy work separate themselves out and they say, oh, all these techniques, you know, I don't need to know them, I'm just going to do different things forever, you know, or something like that. And then on the other hand, you know, all of the people who, you know, want to become, you know, serious health economists or education economists or labor economists or something, I'd say, oh, you know, that's technically naive, you know, methodologically naive. And so, you know, to think about how you go back and forth and how we can actually inform policy debate by doing careful research and skilled research and to see how these techniques filter across. You know, I thought that many of Scott's answers, for example, to some of the methodological questions were very, very sophisticated, right? Who knows all this stuff, right? And it informs the way he thinks about things. And on the other hand, you know, Sanjeev, I'm going to pick on you. You were so fascinated by his data and his problems, you know, yesterday. The look on your face, it was so evident. It was great. And so there's a lot of stuff going back and forth. And I think that it was good that you should see that. And you should remember, as you dive back into your textbooks, you know, your favorite econometrics textbook or your Moscow, Winston, and Green, that there's this larger narrative that you know that we all want to be a part of. And so with that, I'm going to turn you over to Sanjeev, who's definitely a part of this narrative.
So I should begin that by thanking Larry for inviting me to the summer school. I knew Larry for a long time, so it's a direct link. You know, I know him. He probably doesn't know me very well, but I know him very well.
I have memories of you.
So I think I first met you in 1988.
Yes.
Did you move to Cornell in 1988?
That's when I came.
Yeah. And we did a course on the foundations of game theory, epistemology, and so on. And I, in fact, even wrote a paper which you were kind enough to say nice things about. And so we go back a long time, and I was very pleased to be invited to give these talks. And I've never been to mainland China, so I was, you know, especially keen to take it up. And I should say that I was not entirely clear what I was expected to do, and I got the impression I should talk about inequality. And networks. So I try to write down some lectures on networks and inequality. I do most of my work on networks, and it turns out that one of the reasons why networks are important is that they're extremely unequal. In many sort of interesting ways, they're very unequal. And economists then, you know, naturally want to understand if these inequalities in the network translate, why are there these inequalities? And I'll talk about that today. But we also want to understand if these inequalities matter for, you know, from an economic point of view, from a welfare point of view. And so I thought that I would talk about that. Uh, I I should say that I do a variety of work. So I do empirical work, and I also do some experimental work. But most of my work is theoretical. And so one of the questions I had for myself is, what sort of lecture should I give? And I should have asked Larry. I did ask him yesterday evening.
Yeah,
that was a little late.
You had a busy night.
So, but I should have asked him earlier. Anyway, so what I decided to do, as I go along, I might, you know, move around a little bit in the plan, depending on how you react, was to mainly talk about theory. So what I'm planning to do is to take a step back, because I think we had two brilliant lectures yesterday, and great lecturers, very empirical, and very much, very China-focused. I think it's wonderful, and I'm sort of very pleased to be here just to listen to those two lectures. That's, good enough reason to come here. But having said that, I should say at the very outset, I know very little about China, unlike the two speakers we had yesterday. And so I'm going to speak at a slightly more abstract level. I'm going to try and build a bit on what Larry talked about. Again, it's going to be what I think about Larry talked about, because I have heard him tell me what he talked about, and I was not here at the lecture. So he gave us some lectures in Cambridge last year, and he said they were very similar. So I have some vague sort of idea, if I remember vaguely what he talked about. So the closest link to my lectures would be the lectures that Larry presented. And what I'm going to be doing, I think my take on what Larry did is that they were very broad lectures, very sort of fundamental questions and concepts from networks and graphs. He introduced a number of concepts, and he talked about some large-scale phenomena like small worlds. And so I think that's great, and you may want to keep that in mind. I should say, this is, I think, the only country where I can say that honestly, that I wrote a book which is available in the local language. Now, I gathered from some students that they actually didn't know about this book being available in Chinese, but they knew it was available in English. So I felt very embarrassed, that I obviously haven't. I have a copy of the book in Chinese, and I have not dared to ask any Chinese friend to read it and tell me if it has any resemblance to the original English version. So this is a book that I'm told you can download from the web, for free. And I would urge you to download it, because Princeton University Press doesn't pay me any royalties anymore. So, so I think it's...
I'm about the sites now.
So it's a very well-known publishing press, but I've been very disappointed, actually, by the editorial team. The editor who worked with me has, I'm not sure what is the cause and effect, but he left to become a maths teacher. And after that, I've had no dealings with them. So do take a look at the book. It's available. Many of my friends have downloaded it and have smiled at me. So I urge you to look at the book. So the lectures, the book was written in 2007. It was published in 2007. And in the last 8 years, there has been an enormous amount of new work in networks. And I think it's fair to say that networks is one of the more dynamic fields of research in economics today. Just to give you some ideas, since I know many of you are, are sort of master's students and interested in doing a PhD, just by way of, general introduction, I should say that in Europe, there is something known as ERC, the European Research Council, and every year they give out research grants to very promising people working in exciting fields. And I think the field they've given out the most awards to is in networks. And so, there are probably 7-8 people who got these awards, which is quite unusual for a field. And so it's a very lively, very active field of work, and it's also interesting in another sense, which is very unusual, and that is that it is a field which is very alive in many other disciplines, like computer science, or in physics, or sociology, or strategy. And so one of the excitements of doing networks is that, or working in networks, is that you can actually talk to entirely, you know, different communities of people who think about the same kind of questions, but in a very different way. And so, you know, it's very exciting and also very challenging. And it's very unusual. Most of the things that economists do, you know, they do in a very particular way, of course, but they also ask questions and they ask, you know, they're interested in issues which some other disciplines might be interested in, but it's not the case that so many other disciplines are working on the same kinds of questions at the same time. So why is it that networks are so, you know, why is it that there's such a tremendous interest in networks at the moment? So of course there are many reasons for any such large-scale phenomena, but one major reason is that you have a lot of data on networks. So 20 years ago, you know, if you wanted to have data on networks, you would go to a classroom and ask questions about how many friends do people have, and then put it together, and if you had a data with 500 students in a high school, and, you know, with their friendships, and you studied it, that was a reasonably respectable size of, you know, data, and you could look at it over 5 years, and, you know, this would be quite significant. If you sort of fast forward now to 2015, it's very common to have empirical projects where you have thousands and thousands of people or nodes, maybe even millions, interacting in real time, okay, like a mobile telephone network, and you have data for 3 months. Okay. So it's just absolutely staggering. You can actually do work on this kind of a data set of this size. And because of the panel structure of the data, you can actually tease out many, many relationships. And because of the size of the data, the confidence with which you can make empirical statements is great. So it's this availability of data and the ability that we have to process this data. Okay, that's a major advance. And it's because networks have always been viewed as interesting, but always viewed as empirically not very feasible, because you know, you just don't have good data. That constraint has been relaxed. And as that constraint has been relaxed, the number of questions that people always knew were network questions have now become feasible. You know, you can actually address them from an empirical point of view. And it's that, you know, that feasibility that makes policy making, you know, feasible. You can actually ask questions, you can quantify network effects, and then you can make policy descriptions, or you can do viral marketing for companies. And it's because of that interest that there is actually a lot of excitement from the practical applied point of view. Okay, and that's the guiding, that's what sort of really the main engine of excitement in the work on networks. So unlike many other fields in economics, historically, networks is an unusual animal, because often things happen in the theoretical realm, and they stay there, and the excitement is great, but the larger community, people at large, are not very interested, because it's a very abstract and hard to measure problem. Networks has the opposite problem, that it's, you see it everywhere. Okay, so once you start thinking of networks, in fact, you cannot actually not think about them. Okay, so let me show you. So this is a very simple network. I don't know whether Larry showed this to you. This probably doesn't look, you know, like anything, but this happens to be Jean Giraud's co-author network from 1990 to 2011. And so Giraud is sitting somewhere here in the middle. And the links are the people with whom he has published a paper. Okay, so this is, of course, it's not a physical network, it's a social network. It's created by people when they decide to work together. Okay. And you'll see, if you look at it for some time, and actually you can look at similar networks, if you go online, you can look at similar networks, you will see that there are. So first of all, when you see a picture like that, I know you've seen Larry's, you've heard Larry's talk, so now you have a good idea what you should do about a network like this, how you should see it, okay, what you should look for. And what I'm going to try and do today in the lecture is I'm going to think about networks like these. And there are many other networks. So here's another network. This is the World Wide Web. It's a very small picture, very small sort of subset of the World Wide Web, and it's very dated. So what's different between the Tyrol network and this network is that these links have arrows. These are hyperlinks. And these the nodes here are web pages. And so what I want to do is I would like you to keep in mind that many networks, let's see if I have another one here. Here's another one. This is a very famous network. This is the network of Florentine families. The resolution is not very good, but you see the Medicis in the middle here, yellow. The Medicis are a major family, of course, a Florentine family, and they were sort of ruling Florence for several hundred years. This family is about the different ties between the major families in Florence. It's a very famous network picture. And again, this is what I want us to do today is to think about social networks, mainly. And I won't be talking about infrastructure networks. And I won't be talking about physical sort of telecommunication networks. And I will not be talking about airline networks. These are all networks, in some way, that are created by human beings. Okay, and so I want us to think about what is it that makes people create links. So I want to ask, why are these people creating the links, and why are they creating the networks in this way? Why do these networks have these sort of properties? Why do they look like this, and why does it matter? So that's the kind of question I want us to think about. And so I'm going to sort of, I'm going to think about, these are fairly general questions. So I could have taken a friendship network. So for instance, I could ask each of you to name friends in this room, and I could plot that. So it could be that, for instance, you think of someone as a friend, but this person doesn't think you are a friend. It is quite normal. So but I could plot these relationships. Okay, and that would give me a network. So now I could ask, where is this network coming from? Why is this network does it have any distinctive properties? So one of the things that I would find if I actually wrote down a network like this, for instance, would be that there would be a big difference between men and women. Typically, the men would have friendships mostly with other men, and the female students here would have friendships mostly with other female students. Okay, that may not be true here, but that's a general sort of pattern you see in most of these networks where there is a gender difference. So if you were now to look at, in some other countries, there would be ethnic divisions. And if you were to look at friendship patterns, you will see that in some countries, you would see that people of particular races will make friendships mostly within the race, within the ethnic group, and not across. So these are patterns in the network that you see when you brought these networks. Okay. So we want to understand why is it that these networks have these features. And that is the bulk of work in, for instance, in physics or in computer science or in many other disciplines. But economists, we are always driven by somehow welfare type questions, which is why we are sort of, for instance, here we are gathered to talk about inequality. So we are very interested in, for example, if you look at this network, you will see that there is, if you sort of zoom in, you will see there are people out here who have lots of connections. Okay, they have many co-authors. But there are also people who seem to have very few co-authors, like this Mr. Green here, he has three co-authors. So you sort of want to ask, does this inequality in connections lead to inequality in income? Does it lead to an inequality in productivity? Okay, does it lead to an inequality in impact? Okay, or research impact, or fame? Or does it lead to, you know, so those kinds of questions, you know, we can ask about the economic implications of the network structure. So those are the kinds of high level questions that I'm going to try and talk about today. So let me now zoom in a little bit and so I gave you some sort of first you know, just the first order thoughts about when you think about a differential network, where does it come from? But let's now begin to look a little more closely why we should think that social connections would have a relation to inequality. So the theme of the lecture that I'm going to give today will be really the connection between the topology of the network, behavior of people in the network, and the welfare implications. Okay, so what I want us to do is to begin to think about why should networks matter? Why should we think that being well connected is going to be different from being poorly connected? What does it mean to be well connected in a graph? So I think Larry must have taught you about degrees, centrality, closeness, distances, and so on. These are all ways of thinking about location in the network. And we want to ask, if you're interested, for example, in who gets a good job, and is it the case that if you're well connected, you get a better job? So that's a very concrete question. There are many people in this class, they all want to look to do, let's say, a PhD, and they want to apply to do a PhD. And when they apply to do a PhD, they will have to write, you know, a letter why they want to do a PhD, and they will ask their supervisors to send a letter of recommendation, a reference letter. Okay? That's a connection. This is a network they are in. And certainly when I was a graduate student and when I applied, I was told it's very important to find supervisors who are going to write for you. They should have a connection with the place you're applying to. Those people should trust these people who are writing. Okay? So why is this relevant? This is relevant because there are all sorts of information issues here. You're applying, they don't know who you are. They want to hire you, they want to admit you, but only if you're good enough. And they have to figure out if you're good enough. There's asymmetric information. Okay? And the network is helping resolve this information asymmetry. It's helping sort of mitigate this information asymmetry. So that's a key role of networks. In labor markets, it's a key role of networks in the transmission of technology, the diffusion of technology. So we're going to ask quite simply whether well-connected people are going to just get better jobs, get higher paid jobs. They're going to have better ideas, they're going to write better papers, they're going to earn more income, they're going to be more famous economists. So that's a simple set of questions. We can now run it through the lens of a network problem. Another sort of major reason why we think about networks is it's easy to see if we go back to the lecture that Professor Zhang gave yesterday. And this is about, if you remember, he was talking about gift exchange. Okay. So if you think about gift exchange, there are sort of many different perspectives on gift exchange. One is that, you know, you have to throw these lavish parties and waste lots of food. But in fact, there's a more benevolent motivation for gift exchange, which is that, you know, I could have a negative shock, I might be ill, I need help, so I go to Professor Zhang and he says, well, you know, you'll be our friends, and so I will lend you some money today. And so then, you know, I owe himself a favor, and then 2 years from now, maybe he needs money to do some work for him on his house or send his son to, you know, to school, and he borrows, I can lend him some money. So it's a way in which you share risks. Okay? It's a way in which you insure against risks. And that's very important if foreign insurance markets are not well developed. So in a development context, networks are very important because they have community, there's a community network which helps share risks, which is how, you know, which is very important because there are these incomplete markets. So more generally, of course, one could think of reciprocal relations as a favor exchange system. It's not just in developing countries and poor farmers in China. It could be, you know, if you are a senior corporate executive and you're looking, you can do favors to each other. Okay, it's not just, it could be large firms being nice to each other. So this is like a repeated game story. I don't know if you've done game theory and if you've done repeated games, the theory of repeated games. So this is just a general version of the theory of repeated games. Here you have people embedded in a network and they are being nice to each other. Okay, depending on the relationships they have. And again, the question would be that if you have many connections, then you can ask help from many people. If you have very few connections, when there's a shock, you're going to go under because you don't have enough connections. So the idea is that in a community with many connections, you know, to be more resilient. Because when there are shocks, bad things happen to particular people, they can get help from other people. So the system is more resilient. So that's another reason why social connections should have a bearing on welfare. So once you begin to see this, and I'm going to have a formal model later in today morning to flesh this out, you will see that there are huge advantages to being in a good network, in being the right network, in the right place in a network. So once you have that idea, then of course people are going to try and, you know, adjust their network. If I know that it's a great idea to be in the middle here, I'm going to try and form connections with people. I may not be good enough, no one wants to work with me, but I will try very hard. Right? So that's the idea, a very simple idea, why it's a good first order approximation to think about networks as being deliberate activity. Of course, there are many things, you know, I'm born in a family, that's not something I choose. And that's a link I have with my parents and, you know, with the relatives, and that's sort of given to me. But over time, you know, I might migrate, which I've done. I was born in India and I migrated out, and slowly I've tried to keep relationships with some of my relatives and not with many others. So in some sense, you know, people move along. And this is an important part of, you know, how modern life is. Okay, so when I started working on networks 20 years ago and I presented work on network formation, people thought it was really exotic. Now, you know, in the age of Facebook, if I talk about network formation, people think it's banal. You know, people do linking and dissolving links basically every morning, you know, along with their breakfast. So it is entirely bland and banal. So there's nothing novel or surprising about it. And so what I'm saying is, you know, probably, you know, it takes a bit of digesting for middle-aged men, but it's just, I think, people do, you know, young people do as a matter of course. So what I'm going to do is, you could ask, you could go to Facebook, and actually our friends who have done it, you could go to Facebook and you could ask, can we have your data on friendship? Okay, and then you could ask, what are the properties of the Facebook network? Who's friends with whom? Who's forming friendships? Who's cutting off friendships? You know, and then look at the dynamics of the Facebook network. And then you could ask, why does it matter? Right? You could ask, why should anyone care about Facebook network architecture? But before you get there, you need to have a theory. You need to have some ideas about why the network is being created the way it is being created. What are the laws governing this network? So those are the kind of ideas that you want to begin to think of, you know, at the end of this lecture. So this is a final bullet point here. We want to have some notion of what is it that makes people form links, and what is it that makes people cut off links. And how does this networking, this link formation activity, give rise to these large-scale networks? So what I'll be doing and talking about today is mostly social networks, but the way of thinking about this is equally applicable to our airline company. You have an airline company which is competing with another airline company for passengers. What is it doing? It's actually creating flight networks, and it's pricing them. So just like you think of pricing and advertising in an industrial organization, now you have the network topology as a strategic variable. And it's really the same general principle at work. You want to ask, what kinds of flights do I want to create? What kinds of cities do I want to connect? And what kinds of links I do not want to have if I want to be a successful airline? The same idea. Yeah, and so it's just at a high level, it's really the same way of thinking. So there is, of course, a lot of work on all these different topics, and what I'm doing in these slides is just walking you through some of the key references. And these slides I'll be sharing with Marie, so you will have access to the slides. And I have tried, so at the end of each of my lectures, you will have a set of references. Okay, so if you want, you can look some of these up. So they're reasonably complete, the lectures. So I've already talked about the information transmission role of networks. I've talked a little bit about social networks and preferences, but this is a little more, in some ways it's a little more foundational, a little more fundamental. So one reason, this is not something that economists I think have much to say about, although they think it's very important. And this is the idea that social networks shape the way we, our preferences. If you are in a certain family, you are in a certain community, you think certain, you have some values, you have some preferences, and you think something's very important, and other things are not important. You learn about doing certain things, and you don't learn so well about doing other things. So in a sense, the idea that you are in a certain social network shapes the sort of person you become. This is a sort of, at some level, it's a fairly obvious idea, but it's something that is hard to pin down empirically. It's hard to work out exactly how the social network affects preferences and values. But it's something that's clearly very important. And so, for instance, if you read Adam Smith, you know, it's an 18th century book on economics, you will see that he says, for instance, that poor people are poor mainly because they don't have aspirations to become rich, not because they don't have the abilities. And so this idea that, you know, why is there inequality? Why is it that people are poor? There can be many reasons for that, of course, and it's a very deep problem. But at the very start, already in Adam Smith's work, you know, there is a lot of discussion about people's motivation, people's aspirations. And recently, there's of course a lot of interest in this question, and there is, for instance, an anthropologist, Barbara, who's been working on this idea of aspirations as a way of thinking about poverty. And Deborah Gray, who's a friend of many of us, you know, he's talked about aspirations, those are written on aspirations. Another Parnell figure, Bob Frank, has a very famous book, Choosing the Right Pond. And this is on social comparisons. You know, what's your social comparison group? Is it mostly about people who are making a lot of money, or is it about people who are doing deep, you know, deep research, or make, you know, making beautiful paintings? Is it an art community? Is it a research community? Is it a money-dominated community? That's going to be very important in, you know, the way people actually behave. And so this idea has been around in economics, at least since the time of Hedden, which is about 20 years ago. But again, networks are going to matter because they're going to shape who you compare yourself with. Let me sort of move on. I've talked about these things, and I will leave you with these slides. So I'm going to make a couple of remarks on sort of how do we locate natural formation work. So it's sort of fair to say that it's a theoretical innovation, this idea that people create networks deliberately looking at cost and benefits. This is a very economic way of doing things, and like all these economic approaches, there's domain where this way of looking at things is legitimate, is reasonable. But in social networks, there is a long history. So a lot of social structure work, social networks work, really originates in sociology. And in sociology, the tradition for a long time has been the idea that if you're born in a social structure, the social structure defines the role you're supposed to perform. It defines your values, and therefore shapes, and in fact more or less determines what you do. So there is a famous line, if economics is about choice, sociology is about why you don't have any choice. You do what you're asked to do by your social role. Okay. So this is of course the old idea, and on the other hand, there's always been a tension, even in sociology, between people who think structure is deterministic, and it tells you basically what you should do. And the idea that you have agency, that you actually have autonomy, you can choose what to do. And it's important to keep this in mind, because I think it's important to realize that there's this tension between the social structure, the value, the preferences you have, and the autonomy you have. This is this intersection of autonomy and sort of constraints within which we operate, within which we function. So this is, I've given some references here, and I think James Coleman he's probably one of the best known sociologists who tried to work at this intersection between larger scale social structure and autonomy of individual choice. So in the last 20 years or so, economists have developed a fairly elaborate theory of network formation, which is driven by these incentives. And my book and other books in economics actually develop this theory and elaborate on its different applications. And so today I'll talk a little bit about that, but it's important to remember the context in which this theory was developed, and what is the, if you like, the novelty of the theory relative to the traditional work in sociology. Here are the references, and so there's a very long list of references here, but what I've tried to do is I've mentioned the books in italics, and many of the books are easily available online, so you should be able to.
And very long.
Well,
Coleman's
long. If you think Coleman is long, you should try the Pierre Bourdieu distinction.
Even Ryan Burke, why use the sentence from the very
Well, so that should give you first, an introduction. And I imagine that Larry had many more slides, and he had many more references. But you probably get started with this. And let me pause and ask if there are any questions at this point. Yes.
So, should we be thinking about, or are you going to be thinking about networks as cause, effect, or mechanism, or some of each?
Can you hear?
Yeah.
So I'm going to try and do both. I'm not going to be talking about empirics at all. So if you're coming at it from, you know, a measurement or an estimation identification perspective, then I'm happy to talk about that, but the lectures will not really get close to the empirical questions. I'll be mostly talking about models and very simple models, actually, of theoretical models. Usually, of course, in you know, when you go out there, people are doing both. They form networks, and they have some reasons to form networks, but once the networks are there, that they affect behavior. So I think both things are happening. And I'm sure Larry talked about this, or I'm sure he has much to say about these things. He doesn't want to work on it. So, but I was just going to say, this is not what I've been talking about, but clearly this is very important. It's a substantive question, but I'm not going to be talking about it. I'm not going to be talking about estimation identification issues. Is that what you...
I would think that even how you think about the theory in a sense would be affected a little bit by whether your aim is to think about a network that would affect the cause of my if
sure.
You want to think about the effect, then maybe you focus on unequal endowment and how those play out in terms of network formation, for example.
Yeah, so, okay, so I'll come back to this question later, but let me very briefly respond to what you're saying. So what I'm going to be talking about today is a mix of work. Some of it is going to be very new work. Some of it is going to be sort of work which has gone on for the last 10, 15 years. And in the older work, the idea has been to create lots of heterogeneity, network heterogeneity, starting from very little ex-ante heterogeneity. And so in a sense, to show that networks amplify initial heterogeneity. So that's the way I think maybe it addresses what you're getting at. So the way I would think about some of this work is that we may start with slightly different endowments, we may start with particular preferences, and they lead to certain macroscopic properties of the networks. But in the process of these networks arising, they also shape our behavior, and the networks themselves have, if you like, multipliers which amplify. So that's the very rough, in a way, broadly. Yes.
So I actually think there's a fascinating research challenge here, which is actually just kind of one step beyond the current frontier, and it's really the following. So on the one hand, we have papers like those stemming out of the Jackson and Lewinsky framework, where we say, okay, we want to study network formation, and so we'll just assume that there's some value function for networks, and then figure out what networks form, and this is the stability concept and all that. So then we're thinking about networks as an effect, right? Then on the other hand, we have work like some of the work that I did way back when, right, when you have games played on networks. And so the networks are, in fact, the cause of these outcomes that we see, you know, in a population. The network structure affects the distribution of play, okay? Now, you can integrate those in a rather simple way by saying, okay, suppose that you have a game on a network, and then you can say, what's the value of the equilibrium for each network, and then use that as a value function to do Jackson-Walensky. So now you have the, you know, the play, the outcomes, essentially causing, you know, the networks cause the play, okay? And then people thinking about what game they want to play, right, end up choosing the network, right? And that's the beginning of an interrelationship, right? Or rather, a kind of reverse, what I want to say is a co-causal framework. But we really haven't seriously addressed the fact that the outcomes of networks and the formation networks are, in fact, co-determined. And so I just sketched for you in the last two sentences one model of how to do that. But this is a remarkably untapped area.
So I actually disagree, but I disagree in the sense that this is actually work where there are probably about 50 papers. So I'm astonished that you're saying this. And they have been published in leading journals.
Well, I don't think...
So maybe they're no good, but they are there.
Well, we should talk about that, because I don't think that those papers really in, they either do network formation or they do the result of what the action on the network
but I...
So I will actually present a paper which does both.
Right, right. Well, there
and
are
some, seven
there
years
are,
old.
There are, this is not an empty set, right?
Yeah.
But I'm saying it's a remarkably thin set.
Sure,
and
sure.
An interesting set, I might add, except for your paper, which I haven't yet seen.
Okay.
relative to what's out there. And in particular, how to do something empirical with that.
I think that's the question that was being asked earlier, and I think there's actually a lot of work, there's a lot of interest in that now, empirical interest. I'm sure Larry is aware of these papers, but you know, there's actually quite an interest in exactly this problem that you have behavior and network formation going on at the same time. And there is a reasonable literature, actually, a number of models which try and do. Make an attempt at doing this. And so I'll talk a little bit about that towards the end of my third lecture, so you can get a flavor of that. But any other questions or? Unusual the way I'm presenting the lecture. So what I thought I would do is first talk about how given networks matter and for behavior. And I'm going to do that in a very specific context. So there is a very old a classical question. And I think it actually goes back a long, long time. In the last century, there's been interest in this. Very broadly, this is, if you like, a question of definitions. You know, it comes out of definitions, but it's also a question at the heart of the development process, the relationship between communities and markets. So the idea being that historically, most economic exchange was local and was carried out through with dense social connections. Okay, so. And over time, people go to their supermarket and just buy things, mostly. And so in some sense, the economic exchange is not grounded in deep social relationships, but is, at arm's length. It is an anonymous price-setting mechanism. Well, there is a price-setting supermarket, and you just go and buy from the supermarket. You don't have social relationships with people in the supermarket. Whereas in the past, you might go to a little market and you would be buying from the same person, a fishmonger or from a vegetable grocer, week after week. And so there is a sense in which it's a repeated relationship. And whereas if, now you're living in Beijing and you go, you do most of your shopping in these big shops, you have probably very little social relationship with these people. It's a different kind of social relationship at the very least. And so this idea that community and markets, and in fact the state is also a big player, and the state is different from social relationships. The fact that the states have become much more extensive, much more deeply involved in the lives of people, and the fact that markets have become much more extensive, has meant that the social sphere has shrunk. And so this theme has been, I think it was first articulated probably in the Karl Polanyi book, but it's been going on certainly already in the 18th century. There was talk about this tension between markets and commerce and social relationships. So the question is whether markets crowd out social relationships and social networks. And a lot of people, there is a very popular book by Michael Sandel, The Moral Limits of Markets, What Money Cannot Buy. I don't know if it's popular in China, but it's, I'm sure that in the US at least, it was a big public, very, very much in the public sphere. And again, it's one of the books that I would say it's a little tedious, but it's got lots and lots of very nice examples, and it's worth reading. And you could again probably get it online. So it's a nice book to read. You could probably read it today before going to bed. Yes?
Even shorter, by the way, is his Atlantic article, which essentially sums up all things in the book.
Okay, so that's probably, maybe you could send it to Marie.
I will link.
Yeah. So that's a nice.
A lot of time you can spend on YouTube.
On YouTube.
But, no, on him, on Sandel.
Yeah, so YouTube is another place you can actually get his lecture on YouTube. So he makes the point that markets are actually crowding out all manner of things, not just community, but also moral ideas people have. And one reason he thinks it's not a good thing is that markets, he thinks, actually increase inequality. Because basically they value things like purchasing power, and so people who have lots of purchasing power, they benefit disproportionately. There are, of course, other, and this is an argument that goes back to Condorcet, and it goes back actually a long time, and it's very related to Enlightenment in Europe, the idea that markets and commerce actually can only take place against a background of trust. You can't actually buy and sell things in a big city if you don't trust people, quite simply. It's not just your family. You have to trust people out on the street and to carry on living in Beijing. And you can only do that if you can trust people at large. So in some sense, there is a very simple sort of an idea that markets, large-scale markets, require lots of trust. And therefore, they require very different ways of thinking, very different sort of ways of behaving, and naturally reinforce reciprocity, okay, and thereby strengthen social ties. Maybe different kinds of social ties, but they strengthen, you know, a sort of a more diffused but a larger set of social ties. So it's an old debate, and like a lot of these old debates, there is, you know, the anecdotal evidence, but relatively little empirical. Yes.
I always have one wonder when someone makes the first statement, if they begin with an initial condition where there are no markets, or where markets are minimal. At what point in history were there markets minimal, and therefore, what's the relevance of that entire argument?
Yes. So this is, this is a little bit what I was getting at. That I think you need to sort of put this in the context of an empirical context, you know, ask what's the data. Having said that, I think maybe you're trying to get at another question, which is that economic life has always been governed by market-type principles. They may not have been
Drop economic.
Exchange.
Life has been governed as well by economic principles.
Sure. So this is, you know, this is a view, and I won't have time in the lecture today to talk about this, but this is a view, in fact, closer to the view of many economic sociologists. So they actually have this, for instance, Mark Randweber has this view that there was actually probably, there's a lot of social embeddedness of economic action now. And there was also a fair bit earlier, but there were also a lot of markets and, you know, economic life, if you like. All life was governed by economic principles even earlier. So in some sense, you know, this is a big literature, and I don't want to get too, I don't want to sort of contest what you're saying. I see what you're saying. I just want to move on to concrete empirical studies, okay, to bring out some of these things. Okay, but, I mean, your point is well taken. So here's a very nice paper by one of my colleagues, Kailan Munshi, and a speaker who will be here tomorrow, I think, Mark Rose as well. So I want to walk you through this. It's a very it's a nice story, and I hope it will resonate with you, because probably something similar might be happening in China. I don't know whether it is, but I suspect something similar or similar types of pressures should be at work. So what's the, this is a paper which is about 10 years old, and it looks at the city of Bombay, which is also known as Mumbai, which is, I think, probably the largest Indian city. And it is a city which is particularly commercial, industrial. It's a very thriving, dynamic city. And it's also the heart of the business and the stock exchange. So it is the heart of the Indian economy, like the modern Indian economy. It doesn't have the IT part, but everything else is really great. It's on the SSSI2015 city. So in the 1990s, the Indian economy was liberalized, and that meant there was much more trade, there was expansion in the modern sectors, service sectors, which meant that returns to taking up jobs in these sectors increased. And in particular, these sectors were modern sectors, so the language of jobs in these sectors was English. So it meant that when you went to school, the returns from going to an English school had gone up significantly compared to going to a local language school, which is Marathi. So that's the first slide here. So the question is, what effect did it have on school participation? So supposing you're going to school, which school do you choose? And what Munshi and Rosenzweig find is that working class boys adopted the English language schools much less than girls. And there are different working class castes in Bombay. And they found also that the difference between the larger castes and the smaller castes, what was going on was that the larger castes were better represented in the labor markets, because these markets are very networked. So if you are a boy and you're in a large caste, it makes sense for you to go into a Marathi school, because then you can get a job through the network. But if you're a girl, there are no girls working, so there were no networks of girls. And so if you are from the similar, if you are in a small or large caste, but you're a girl, it actually doesn't matter how large your network is. It is not there. There are no networks of girls. So what happened is that girls, first of all, adopted the English language schooling more than boys, and there was no difference between large and small castes. So at the end of the day, in 10 years' time, the gap in English education between girls of high and low caste disappeared. The gap for boys remained intact. And the inequality, gender inequality between men and women fell because the wages in the modern sector were higher than wages in the traditional sector. So this is an example of a situation where you have a social network which is being used to get jobs. And what's happening here is when the market becomes more attractive, people who are disadvantaged in the social network, which is girls, take up the market. People who are advantaged in the social network, that they have a lot of connections, the boys, they remain in the network. So at the end, you see that families who have girls gradually withdraw from this network. So in fact, the network erodes. So this is an example where when markets come in, they erode the network. And they help people who are disadvantaged in the network. So markets actually reduce inequality. Okay. So keep in mind these two arguments. Okay. So that's one. This is a story which has to do with it has to do with this general argument. Okay. So keep in mind this story. Okay. We're going to come back to this when we do a formal model. Here's another example. This is another study from another. Yes.
Would you say a link between that and, let's say, the Christian in South India that escaped the network that was existing and before long were a thing to themselves and had their own approach to education? Was there a similar sort of effect that occurred? I don't think it was the same driver, but I see a lot of examples of where the differences. But this was intentional, most likely, to get the hell out of the terrible network of just taking the nadars and the people in the lower end and stopping them from going anywhere.
Yes.
It jumped the system, and they rose like anything. So I'm wondering.
Yes. So
that isn't the market doing it. It's just now the chance of joining another network, which is kind of outside the network, Christian network, just interesting if you thought about that.
Yeah, so, I'm using, so I mean, maybe you're asking me why do I have this, why am I calling this
market?
Yeah, so actually the title here is globalization.
Yeah.
You could think of globalization not as a market, but a different network.
Yeah.
But so if your question is mainly about terminology, that's fine. I think in other contexts it'll be a little. For instance, I won't have time to talk about that today. But there are many examples where you have a village labor exchange economy. Or you can get wage labor from the city, where there's a fixed wage. And that's closer to a market. So as I said at the outset, I think this is partly a matter of terminology.
Yeah.
But I think the idea is think about, if you like, a local network and something out there. It could be a market, it could be a larger network, it could be a different network. Yes.
Fascinating target. In China, recently there's a widespread of e-commerce. We will observe similar patterns too. So normally in a cluster, local people have advantage. Most entrepreneurs are local people because they have accrued a lot of assets.
Right.
They can start their own business. But right now with e-commerce, it's much easier to set up a business, which opens doors for many migrant workers. So recently I had done a study by Goyal, the largest suitcase cluster. They found most of the new entrepreneurs are migrant workers. I'm working on the top of the platform, online sales. In large because much lower entry cost.
Right.
So this is like Detroit, the creator of another network for the migrant workers. Very similar idea.
I have an application actually to online social networks and newspapers. So in the paper, we have an application to what's happened to newspapers. In fact, in certainly in Europe, but also in the US, newspapers are declining. Newspapers are in trouble. They're dying, in fact. Whereas social networks, there's a lot of information exchange on Facebook, for example, which is non-monetized. And again, the kinds of people who are on the social media are quite different from the people who buy newspapers. In fact, people who buy newspapers are middle-aged people, by and large.
Mm-hmm.
And people who buy, who are on social media are much younger. So it's again a different community of people. It's a very different context, but it has a similar. Okay, so I mean, I think this Munshi and Rosenzweig is a very interesting, very, so it's a nice paper, and I recommend looking at it. We're doing for time. Okay, so I'm going to skip. So I'm going to talk about this because I think that stories are what I think the best way of thinking about these kinds of problems. And so I'll go through the formal model very quickly. And it's going to be a very simple formal model. But so here's another story. Okay. So this is again taken from the 90s, and it's also taken from India because it just so happens that I think my theory is that India is an easy to research country. Okay. So people go and do research in India. It's a big country also. So so yesterday you heard a lot about China. Today you're going to hear a bit more. Well, this is the last slide on India. There will just be lots of maths. Okay, so enjoy this while it lasts. So what is the story here? So the story here is there is a state in the south of India which is called Kerala, which you may have heard of. It's very famous for spices, historically. But it's also, of course, along the sea, so it's also a major, fishing is a big thing. So this story is about what happens. So there are these fishermen, they go out early in the morning, they catch the fish, and fish is very perishable. They come back very early still in the morning and they sell their fish. Okay. And because fish are perishable, you can't go from market to market. You go to one market and you sell the fish at whatever price you can find. If the price is not right, you still sell it, because you can't go to another market, it's too late. So that's the key. So now, in the 90s, mobile telephony came in a big way in India. which meant that the cost of buying these mobile telephones went down. And so lots of these fishermen bought a cell phone, a mobile phone. So the idea was that they would be out there in the sea catching the fish. And now they would call people, okay, and find out where the prices are right, which market. And then they would go to that market. They could go to many markets, you know, they're like spread out along the coast. And they would go to the market where the prices are right. Okay, so that's the main advantage of having a mobile phone. So what happens? Who are the people who adopt the mobile phone, and what happens to profits? What happens to welfare? So first of all, almost all the people who buy fish adopted it. Okay. But only about 70% of the fishing boats owned a cell phone. There was a difference between the large fish and the small fishermen, large boats and the small boats. Most of the large boats adopted the cell phone, fewer small boats adopted it. So the data, this is a very well-known paper by Jensen, and it has very nice data on profits. Profits of all fishermen increased, but the profits of the bigger boats increased much more. So in fact, inequality amongst the fishermen also increased. So here we have a story which goes, if you like, the other way. This is a story where well-connected boats, I won't have time to talk about why they're well-connected, but large boats have many more investors and many more social connections. So these guys are the ones who adopted the mobile phone. And when they adopted the mobile phone, they actually made much more money than these small boats. So this story goes the other opposite direction compared to the Munshi Rosenzweig story. What you're finding here is that better connected people adopt, if you like, the technology, and they gain more than the poorer connected people. So this is a story where a market, if you like, or a new technology reinforces the advantages of the network. The people who are highly connected in the network actually gain more. So what I'm trying to draw out from these stories is that the empirical evidence is actually very mixed. When you have a social network, which is very unequal, some people are very highly connected, some people are very poorly connected, you have a market opportunity that comes along. What it does to this community, who gains, who loses, depends very much on, you know, we see that in one case it goes one way, and in the other case it goes the other way. So what I want us to do is to think about, step back and ask whether there is a simple way of thinking about what's happening in these two contexts, and a general way of thinking about it. By that I mean, is there a theory? Can you come up with a theory to explain these two? Okay, so I'm going to now, as I said, this is a new paper, a fairly new paper. So I'm going to give you a taste of something which is very, very fresh, very, very much sort of ongoing research. And so it gives you a flavor of how some of the economics work combines networks with questions, you know, in let's say, interesting questions about inequality, okay, and development. So these are the kinds of questions. Who adopts markets? Are they the well-connected people or the poorly connected, marginalized people? So this is what James was asking. You know, are there communities which are marginalized and they leapfrog? Or is it the other way around? Inequality. Do markets reinforce existing inequalities in the social networks, or do they actually reduce inequality? Do markets raise or lower welfare in the aggregate? Okay, so those are the kind of questions. And once I set out the model, I'll go back and talk about the application. So I'm going to do it very quickly because I don't want to spend too much time on the maths, but I'm happy to take questions. So I would have liked to draw
You don't have a whiteboard where I could draw something. Well, it's behind here.
Yeah. And this marker's right over here in the corner.
So, can I pull this up? Can I pull one of them up? Mm-hmm. And then I could draw.
See, theorists really want to show it.
Could you bring this up? This is a paper which is a joint work with Julien Gagnon, who's a PhD student in Cambridge. And so just to think about this problem, there's a bit of notation, but it's a very simple model. So I have a set of people, okay, who are in a network. And I have, and each of these people, let's think of Mr. I. First, Mr. I, he chooses action AI, which consists of two actions, XI and YI. Okay? And XI can be 0 or 1, YI can be 0 or 1. It's a very simple model. You choose these two actions. And I'm going to think of X. Okay, I'm going to think of X as a network action. And I'm going to think of Y as a market action. Okay, so this is the network, and so now the key thing to note is that I choose these actions, AI, and everybody chooses actions. And so now I have a set of actions A1, AN. Okay, and given these actions, person I, okay, Mr. I gets some, he's sitting in this network, and I'm going to call this network G. Okay, and so there is this network, and everyone chooses these actions, and therefore I have a set of actions A. And given these actions, there is some payoff. And this payoff is given by this function, phi, which depends on the action that Mr. I has chosen, okay, and it depends on this function xi, okay, which is what is xi? This is the only bit of networky idea and game theory idea that I will be asking you to keep in mind. It's simply the number of people in my neighborhood who choose X. This is Mr. I, or his neighbors, 1, 2, and 3. He has three neighbors, degree 3, and these are the three neighbors that he has. And I want to keep track of how many of them are choosing the network action. So I write that down as, I define the neighborhood of I as n subscript ig, and I look at all the people in his neighborhood who choose x equal to 1. So that's all we really want to keep in mind. And there's a market out here, okay? That's action Y. Action Y is going to be very simple. I want to buy something in the market, I pay a price, and I get some value. Okay. X is where all the network action is.
So could you view that as another network?
I could view that as another network, except that it doesn't matter what people are doing in that network. So what's going to happen here is...
So it's a null network, so to speak.
Yeah, another way to put it is that it's a complete network. But it's, so I'm going to be slightly, I'm going to take a very in the talk today, I'm going to take this very simple view that there is a price out there for action Y, which is PY. When I go and buy Y, I basically pay PY and I get some return. Okay. And it doesn't matter what anyone in the world does. So in some sense, I'm in this local small village. I go to the city and I buy some stuff. What people in the village do doesn't affect what I get out of action Y. That's all I want to capture. Okay. So that's a simple idea. So there's a little bit of notation here. And I'm going to, you know, I'm not going to talk a great deal about this because I'm not sure. You know, I'm not going to use it a great deal, but it's sort of useful to structure. So let me just say that, well, what is one saying? One is saying if I do nothing, then my payoff is zero. Okay, so it's just a normalization assumption. It's not a very, you know, not very, okay, so just normalization. Two is saying that when I choose X zero, it's like dropping out of the network. If Mr. I chooses xi equals zero, then basically it doesn't matter what people are doing in this network. It is as though he has left the network. In other words, it is as though the network has eroded. Okay, so therefore, his payoff does not depend on him. It does not depend on how many other people do x. And I'm going to assume that you know, if you do X, then your payoff is increasing in how many other people do X. So it's a complementarity. I like to do X, the more people do X in my neighborhood. Okay, so it's a very simple way of saying that there is a network externality. There is a positive return to doing the network action when other people are doing the network action. Okay, and this is the key concept that's going to help us organize the empirical work, and it's basically saying how the X and Y related. Okay, so when I'm doing X and I do Y, are my returns from doing Y higher because I'm also in the network? Or are my returns from doing Y lower because I'm in the network? Okay, so this is going to become clear. So it's a little abstract, but this is going to become clear when I go through an example. Okay, so let me just show you an example of what I mean by the payoff function. So here's a simple, relatively simple example that captures many of the ideas. So what is going on here is the payoff of person I from you know, this action profile A in a network G is given by this expression here. So let me start here. So this is saying if I choose action Y, I pay a price for doing Y. You know, I go to the market, I buy some food, you know, I buy some stuff, I buy labor, I buy some clothes, you know, I pay. Similarly, when I go and I buy and I choose X, I might have to pay some price, which could be time, it could be, you know, some effort. I'm doing a favor to a friend. That could be EX. YI is the return from the market action. It's a constant. Notice it doesn't depend on what anyone else is doing. And finally, this is the bit that's at the heart of the story. What is this saying, really? It's saying that the returns from XI depend on how many other people in my neighborhood are doing XI. Okay, so you can see there is a multiplicative term here, which means that the returns are increasing. That's a complementarity. And now, whether YI, the market, increases the returns from the network action or decreases depends on theta. Okay, so if theta, you know, this should be minus one, this is a typo. So if theta is negative, then X and Y are substitutes. And if theta is positive, then the returns from doing Y are increasing in doing X. So this is the main idea that you should take away. So whether markets are going to be good for networks or they're going to be bad for networks is going to depend on whether whether we are looking at complements or substitutes. So Professor Zhang asked, about these platform and the migrant labor, and I was giving this example about Facebook. So the idea here is that in some economic contexts, markets and networks are complements, like in the fisherman's story. If you have lots of network connections, you can exploit the technology more. If you are basically isolated in the network, who are you going to call? What's the point of having a mobile phone? You will not get a mobile phone. So it's well-connected people who are going to get mobile phones. And when they get mobile phones, their network will become even more valuable. In the case of the girls and boys going to school, it's the other way around. So that's going to be crucial for understanding the relationship between markets and networks.
Did the ones with, the poor folks with one vote, they didn't have a lot of friends or relations, or did they have rich people? I'm just curious.
Yes, so what is going on? Yeah. There's been a lot of interest in this study, the Jensen paper, and there's a lot of follow-up ethnographic work. But what's happening is that these big boats and small boats are constituted of fishermen. But if you have a big boat, you also have many investors, because they're investing in your boat. The big boat costs a lot. So that's the first order difference. So in fact, those investors they're not really a social, strictly a social network, but they are part of your network. And they're very keen. So that's one reason why larger boats have larger networks. But of course, larger boats also have more fishermen going out there, and therefore they have larger networks. So there are many sort of complicated, empirical sort of issues here. But broadly, what's happening is that people in larger boats simply have a larger network, both of potential consumers, but also of potential buyer, just people who are interested in helping them have a better deal with their fish. Yes.
Kind of in our counter-argument,
yes,
the network argument with fishermen. So if I get a cell phone, I can call, let's say, three harbors,
yes,
or three potential buyers at harbors, and see what price they offer. Whoever offers the highest price, that's where I go, right? If I have a repeat boat, it's very cheap to make that call, because my margin on each fish is like 5 cents, so one phone call costs me nothing, essentially. If I have a small boat, because I want a few fish, each such phone call is a lot of money relative to the gain I get from selling the fish.
Right.
So I would expect the large boats to be able to easily make 10 phone calls, while the small ones can only make one.
Right. So that's important as well. There is this, I think, to rephrase what you're saying, if I have lots of fish, the returns for me to selling at the right price are larger. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I'm going to be making more calls. And this is a very much the line that Jensen takes. This seems to, this make obvious sense. Okay. So that's why I was saying there's been a lot of ethnographic work showing that, in addition to this, the fact that these large boats also had larger networks helped them get higher prices. So that's the, this is really the takeaway from this paper. The rest of it is just working through all this, just working through the algebra. So let me try and now, so again, let's take a step back, because I'm going to try and walk you through a fairly formal argument. And I know many of you are very well trained, but many of you, there's probably significant diversity in background here.
Yes, Larry. Yeah, so before you get into the argument, into the formal stuff, let me ask you one quick question.
Yes.
And you can defer this till later. I wanted to challenge, I think it was assumption three, a little bit,
Yes, it seems to me that, you know, and I'm thinking about, again, about a conversation we had last night, but all of you, social networks are...
You shouldn't tell them everything that we talked about.
Oh, absolutely. Some things are unavailable. But if we think about social networks and their effectiveness, one of the things that makes social networks effective is the fact that when we're in a community and we're interacting with others, say, reasonably small group of people, right, that if people violate the norms in some way, right, they can be disciplined, they can be punished. This becomes harder in larger communities. And so I might have thought, I mean, you might postulate, right, that at some point when enough people choose X, right, when the population in the community gets large enough, suppose we have a complete crowd for G, and so when the population gets large enough, then the social network begins to become less effective just because norm enforcement becomes weaker. And that would violate the increasing differences, especially since with the fourth assumption that says that the last term in that difference is independent of n.
Yes, so very good point. So let me just take a step back. So of course one could have a richer structure here, okay, and I certainly agree with you that this is one way of one way of thinking about it, but there could be public good aspects, if you like, of these links,
right?
And then, you know, it could go the other way, certainly, and, you know, enforcement of norms would be one example of that.
It seems to me that we have increasing differences over a range seems to me to be exactly what's powerful about social networks, but I find, you know, but increasing differences forever seems less.
Sure, yes. No, I think the point is well taken. So, this is for those of you who are theoretically inclined, this is actually an open, it turns out, looking at this problem with the opposite assumption or with a richer assumption that it's weakly decreasing, for example, or it's, you know, non-monotonic, it's a complicated problem and we actually don't have general results. So if you want to, you know, if you're very excited about this and you want to work on it, then property three is something you may want to think about.
And if you can solve that, then you can write a lot of papers on a lot of topics.
Yes, you don't have to write a lot of papers, you could get a PhD thesis rather, you know, quite easily. Yes. Okay, so that's where, okay, let me just serve. Okay, so I'm not going to, this is a first step in the analysis of these kinds of models. You want to make sure that there is a well-defined outcome. Okay, now, I don't know whether you've done, you know, equilibrium and Nash equilibrium. But let me ask, how many of you are familiar with Nash equilibrium? It's nothing to be embarrassed about. You put up your hand. He actually died, so you know. So I think all of you have heard. I'm not going to ask you what it is. There are some questions that, you know, we don't, it's very embarrassing to ask people about Nash equilibrium, especially. What a terrible story. He just had this crash.
Yes.
Extraordinary.
Ever since then, every time I get into a cab, I put on a seatbelt.
Okay. But so, I'm not going to talk a lot about this, but I'm going to try and give you a feel of how to analyze behavior. So remember, the idea here is there is a payoff function, okay, it has these properties, 1, 2, 3, 4, and I want to ask how for different networks and different payoff functions pi, who's going to choose x and who's going to choose y? That's basically what I was asking. And the key idea in thinking about that problem is actually to think about who's going to choose x, who's not going to choose x. So let's abstract from y for a moment. And notice that I'm going to choose x if enough people around me are choosing x. Okay, remember that the returns from choosing x are growing in n, the number of people choose x. So at some point, it will certainly become attractive for me to choose x. But if I'm going to choose x because the three of you are choosing x, I need to be sure that you want to choose x. Okay? you want to choose X if enough of your neighbors are choosing X. Okay? So they will choose X if enough of their neighbors are choosing X. Okay? That idea is the Q-core idea. So let's try and make that a little more formal. Okay, so the Q-core idea is the Q-core of a graph G is the largest collection of players that have strictly more than Q links to players in GQ. It's a set of people who all have Q links with other people who all have Q links, and so on. So let's describe how do you. Yes?
Can you put the other thing back down?
Okay, can you see this?
Okay. You can?
Okay, all
right. Or would you like me to bring this down?
If you're not going to use the board, bring it up.
Okay. Option value.
Let's bring it down.
Leave it up.
You can always go back up?
Yeah, sure. So do you still write on the board?
Oh yeah, I write on the board with chalk.
You couldn't see much on this board.
I'm not on this board. Right? No, I teach with chalk and I write.
Where do you teach?
Yeah.
You know, what kind of a place do you teach where there's chalk?
Cornell is not as old a university as Cambridge.
Right.
At Cambridge, the chalk is actually the bones of older faculty.
Excellent. So I'm surprised you have the traditional white chalk that you.
Oh yeah.
Wow.
And the best place to teach is in the chemistry department because they have that thick, soft white chalk.
Okay, so how do you work out the Q-core in a network? Here's a network. So it's a very simple algorithm. You keep taking out people who have less than four links. So let's look at this network, and I knock out people who have four or fewer links. So these are the red guys. Then I have a residual network, and now I knock out people who have four or fewer links in that residual network. And I get this network. And now let's look at this network. You will see that in this network, this guy, for instance, has one, two. So he has one, two, three, four, five links. And let's look, you know, at each of the links. This person again has five links, and you can check all these guys have five or more links. Okay? With people who have five or more links. So that's the Q4. So this is where I started with, and I've got the Q4 of this network. So this is going to be a key idea. Because of the complementarity, property 3, this is the key idea that I'll be exploiting repeatedly. So either people will be doing things within the Q4, or they will be doing things outside the Q4. And very roughly, in the complements case, X and Y will be done by the people in the court, and nothing will be done outside. In the substitutes case, X action will be done by people in the Q4, and Y will be done by people outside the Q4. Okay. So that's going to be the key result. Okay. So well connected here, what does it mean to be well connected in this network? It means that you are a member of a Q4. Okay. Notice that it's not the same thing as being well connected, as having high degree. And I'll come back to that. Okay. Just keep that in mind. So let me go on to examples because I'm kind of running out of time. Okay, so this is a key result. So let me walk you through this. What does it say? So for some of you, this is, you know, breakfast porridge. It's very easy to digest and it's fun. And for some of you, probably this is intimidating and very hard going. If it's hard going, just close your eyes and breathe deeply. And I'm going to show you some pictures in 2 minutes. And if this is the sort of thing that makes you think life is worth living, then concentrate on what I'm saying. Okay, so here, what's going on here is I'm going to take any graph G, and that's a social network, and I'm going to look at this payoff function phi, and I'm going to tell you exactly the people who will do X and Y. And as a function of the network. That's the goal of this result. So what is this saying? It's saying that In the substitutes case, okay, it's the people who are in the Q core who are going to do X, and people outside the Q core who are going to do Y, okay, roughly. Okay, this is not exactly what's written here, that's what you should take away. In the strong complements case, or just the complements case, it's the people in the relevant Q core who will do both X and Y. Okay, and it's the people outside the Q core who will do either Y alone, the market, or they will do nothing. Okay, so you see the contrast. In the substitutes case, it's the Q core guys who remain in the network. Okay, and the guys who are poorly connected who go to the market. In the complements case, it's the well-connected guys who do both X and Y. Okay, who go to the market and remain in the network. So that's the takeaway. And let's just now work through some examples. So there are two points that I want to make. First of all, that Q core is a deeper and a richer idea than just degrees. Okay. So well-connected normally means higher degree. I want to argue that actually the network topology, the structure of the network matters. Okay, so I want to show you this by looking at these two examples. So let's look at the let's look at this picture here. And what you see that, so this is the substitutes case and this is the complements. So what you see here, So let me actually move to this one. It's easier to illustrate the point in this picture here. So what's going on here is, let's look at Mr. Nine. Mr. Nine is actually, he's got lots of connections. He's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. By contrast, let's look at Mr. 10. Mr. 10 actually has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So he has fewer connections. Okay. But if you look at the, if you look at the indicators here, what are we learning from this? We are learning that it's this blue, dense blue node that's actually in the Q core. And this Mr. 9 is not in the Q core. Why is that? Because he's connected to people who are not sufficiently well connected. So if you look at Mr. 9, his neighbors, this neighbor is poorly connected. Here's another neighbor who's poorly connected. And, you know, we go across and we check, here's another neighbor who's poorly connected. So these neighbors, there are many neighbors, but they're all poorly connected. And therefore they don't choose the right hand, they don't choose the X action. Okay. And therefore, Mr. 9, who's rather well connected in the degree sense, does not choose 9 of the action. Mr. 10 is much less connected, he has a lower degree, but they are mostly well-connected people who are themselves well-connected. Okay, so that is why 10, it's not quite a clique, but it has that, I don't know if whether Larry talked about the idea of a clique, but did you do cliques on Monday?
Yeah.
Yes. So it's not quite a clique, but it is, it's pushing towards lots of connections within a core set of people. So that's the first idea. The second idea is that strategic structure, the strategic relationship, whether substitutes or complements, is key. Okay. And you see that very nicely if you look at this picture. So this is it looks like a my co-author is very, I don't know, I told him repeatedly not to draw it like this, but he drew it, and then I didn't sort of feel like drawing it by myself because I would have said,
yes,
it does. I don't know what kind of airplane you fly in.
Maybe SpongeBob being tortured.
Okay.
Well, what's the name of the guy? The Starfin?
Okay, so what are we doing here? We're looking at two networks are fixed, okay, the top and the bottom. What I've changed is, on the top I have substitutes, on the bottom I have complements. And what I see is, notice that this red cross is a situation where you choose a network action, and the blue, dark blue is a situation where you choose the market and the network action. So what happens here in the substitutes case is that the well-connected core chooses the network action and the marginalized, poorly connected people outside the queue core choose the market action. Okay, y equal to 1. Whereas in the confidence case, you have a reversal. It's the queue core that chooses the network and the market action, and the marginalized non-core members who choose neither. So that's, that gives you a feel of the second point here, that for a fixed structure, the behavior is going to be shaped by whether you're looking at complements or substitutes. Okay. So what's going on here is, it's a way of thinking about how behavior in networks is shaped by the structure, but also the economic background of the problem. This is the way that economists think about networks. And increasingly, this is the reason why networks are interesting for economists. You take a problem in international trade, you take a problem in macroeconomics, you take a problem in crime, you take a problem in diffusion of technology. Problems that economists think are very important. You have models for 50 years to study those problems. You bring networks into those problems, and you show that there is value added to bringing the networks into those models. There's value added in terms of greater empirical sort of sophistication. There is value added in terms of explaining puzzles, okay, that have been difficult to explain earlier. So what's going on here is, so in the two examples we looked at, people have talked for hundreds of years about markets and community. And what we see here is that in this simple example, in the substitutes case, when the market comes in, essentially the people at the margin, the periphery, they will drop out. They will choose the market action, and you can interpret the market action as withdrawing from the network, which means the network will erode. Okay, it will gradually shrink. Here, on the other hand, this is not the best example to show that, but in fact, the market will reinforce the core of the network. More generally, what's going to happen is that gradually people exit from the network, and as they exit, other people exit from the network. So the dynamics of the network will be slowly unraveling. Okay. Here, this is happening all in one shot, but actually, it will happen over time. That's sort of the big sort of big picture takeaway from this exercise. So now, of course, now that we have this result, we can start doing all kinds of, we can start addressing all manner of economic questions. So we can ask, we can define something called market participation. How many people go to the market? How does that depend on the network? How does it depend on the phi function? Okay, and you can address that sort of question. But let me talk a little bit about welfare. So this is a question, for example, in the Sandel paper, Sandel book. And this is more generally a question that comes up repeatedly in all the work on networks and markets. Okay, whether markets and networks, when they come together, whether welfare goes down, whether inequality goes up. These are the big questions that people have in their mind. And they are central to a lot of work in famous work, books like Jim Scott's book on the moral economy of the peasant. So what we find here is a very crisp and general result. In the case of complements, the introduction of the market always increases welfare. So welfare is defined in a very simple way. It's just the sum of utilities. Whereas in the case of substitutes, because people drop out of the network, other people in the network who remain in the network are going to lose. And so they may lose more than the people who go to the market. They gain in the net market. And therefore, overall welfare might actually decline. And that's, for example, in the Munshi-Rosenzweig paper, that is, they don't quite prove it, but they suggest that that might be what's happening in these Bombay communities. So here's a, I don't dare to present this with James sitting here, but anyway, so I didn't know he was going to be here, so I'm going to do it. So there are many ways of measuring inequality, and I'm doing something very crude here. Okay, I'm just looking at the ratio of the largest earnings to the lowest earnings. It's like the range, it's a normalized variant of earnings. So it's very crude. Okay. I could do Gini coefficient. Did you talk about Gini coefficient?
Did I?
I could do the same exercise with Gini coefficient. And I, you know, if I had attended James's talk, I could probably do it with some other things. So here are some other measures. And I just want to say that there are, you know, it's a very sophisticated field, very rich, and there are, and I'm doing something which is very simple, and but I think it's quite robust. So the idea here is simply to ask, there is a network, market opportunities arise, people join the network, people join the market. What happens to inequality? So that's the, so here's the answer to that question. In the case of substitutes, the introduction of the market always decreases inequality. So it's always a good idea when markets, you come into an unequal social situation. When markets come in, essentially the people who are most disadvantaged in the network have a better outside option. So they will always weakly increase. The guys who are in the network who stay remain in the network will either remain as before or will weakly lose, and therefore the ratio will always go down. In this ratio I was talking about, this ratio will always go down in the case of substitutes. And a similar argument can be made in the case of Gini coefficients. It is going to go down. In the case of complements, things are more complicated. But again, the answer in the interesting case is straightforward. If you have an interior solution, that means some people join the market, but not everybody joins the market, then inequality, strictly, it will weakly increase. Okay. So this is the case where people are in a network which is unequal. When you have a market which is complementary, essentially, the advantages of people in the network are reinforced. Okay, and so they gain more than the disadvantaged people in the network. And so that's the main result. So this is the summary, and let me just pause to take any questions. But that's the takeaway from this model. It addresses questions at the intersection of markets and community, and it looks at sort of high order things that economists are very interested in, welfare, inequality. Yes.
So the first thing is the thinking about that other option of being the market seems a bit iffy, but it might be viewed as just having more options.
Yes.
You know, maybe it's another network. And I always look at things like that. Maybe the general statement is one of introducing other options or other networks. But the second comment is, why do I care that inequality went up in the second case, really? The poor folks are doing a hell of a lot better. That's a great thing. Rich folks are doing a lot better. Cool. The first case, I'm happy because the poor folks are doing better. And the rich folks aren't affected because of the way things are structured. That's cool. So I was just wondering if inequality here is maybe something that isn't so important.
But what can I say? you all missed your inequality. You don't think it's important? Well, I'm happy to live with that. What can I say?
Yeah, I've said it in other contexts like that as well.
Go ahead.
All right. Was the Rawlsian criteria that I'm sure about, right? And you know, you pick your measure and you proceed.
But even if you use any inequality measure, you
will be. Rawls is always going to be happy with outside options.
Yeah.
Because the worst top guy is always better off.
So I'm a little troubled with this kind of argument because, you know, we always. What we're doing in some sense here is looking at really a partial equilibrium model.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And you know, we do that and so we can get some analysis off the ground and we see that the income shifts in certain ways. But if everybody's getting richer, that's good. Okay. But we know that those income changes are going to cause relative price changes that we don't track in these models. Okay. And you know, if for example it became the case that everything got more expensive, right, because of this, right, you would be, you know, that would be we need to call it, what I want to argue basically is that it's hard to talk about what's happening to inequality unless you actually look on the equilibrium ramifications for this.
Right.
So, for instance, let me just finish the thought. Things, if goods that poor people consume become more expensive because the rich get richer, okay, then they may in fact be worse off, right? So measuring income isn't necessarily, measuring, you know, renminbi income is not the right thing to do necessarily. We're actually interested in real consumption and with all of the problems that accompany measuring that, right? But that could easily be moving in directions that we can't see because we left that out of the
market. Sure, yes, and I think this is it's a very complicated and you know, it's a very big subject. This is a very, very small partial model. It's just getting at this very simple idea of, you know, whether markets are going to reinforce existing inequalities or not.
I guess the statement I want to make is exactly that. That this is not a model in which it is, I think, worthwhile to assess whether or not inequality increasing or decreasing is a good or a bad thing. The wealth are consequences of that. But there is, you know, it is a model that gives us a positive finding about inequality, and then we can make of that what we want. And,
sure.
And what we're going to have to make of that, if we want to do welfare economics, and I'm not so big on welfare economics actually, but if you want to do welfare economics, you're going to need to really, you know, one would need to elaborate a model much more in order to worry about these kinds of questions, which doesn't mean that they're not important, they're extremely important. It just means you have to look at.
Yeah, I mean, I should say that, yes, I agree that these price effects are, yeah, so I mean, I would urge you, I mean, if you're, you know, amongst the students here, if you're interested in these sort of things, it's worth reading some of the older work, for instance, the Jim Scott book on Moral Economy in the Desert. It's a very major piece of work, and it's, of course, written very much as a non-economist, but it is about a problem economists think about, you know, very hard. And it's worth reading the Michael Sandel book. When I read it, every page made me more and more upset. And I began to think that I'm actually an economist. You know, it's only when you read non-economists that you realize how much of an economist you are. When you hang out with economists, you keep thinking, you know, you're not really like other people.
No wonder you like Sandel.
But anyway, I thought he was completely wrong. Actually,
of course, but then you feel your tribal membership. You feel your identity. You only feel your identity when you confront yourself with the other.
With the other.
That sounds a little anthropological for you here, but we'll move on.
Okay, so
we want to. By the way, you want to take a break?
Yeah, I'm going to take a break in 2 minutes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let me. Sort of, I'm getting close to 11. So let me. Yeah. So I think that. I just want to say a few words about the literature, because I think that's one of the things that you may want to take away from these lectures this week. That very often, you know, we are going to present very particular, very small models like the one I presented. I should say that the point of writing a model is to be very, very simple and to be actually very abstract. And a good model is one which is completely false, which is completely unrealistic, because it captures the essence of the problem. The world is a very rich place. People get up in the morning, they yawn, you know, they go and brush their teeth. That's not really what this model is about, and it should not be about this. So models, if they're good, are going to be absolutely trivial. And once you see the model, the result should be absolutely obvious. So that is true, that's a property of some of the best models that have been written. In fact, it should be a property of models that you write, it should be. So having said that, the point of these models is they try and address very big questions. So this question about markets and community goes back a long time, as I said. And you know, I've put these references in. Of course, they're all, many of them are French, because my co-author happens to be French speaking. And he claims to have read some of this. I actually, I'm less sure about that. But for what it is worth, there are, it actually goes back. And I did actually read a book by Hirschman, Arguments for Capitalism Before Its Triumphs. It's a wonderful book. So if you want to read something, you know, that I think is really a first-rate piece of writing, and you can read it very well, it's very well written. I would urge you to read it. It should have been, I hope I cited it. I'm not sure actually I've provided the full. This is the Hirschman book, The Passions and the Interests.
Oh, yes.
It's an absolutely extraordinary book. So, actually, all these books that I mentioned here, the Polanyi book is almost unreadable, so I would not recommend it to my worst enemy. But the Scott book is great. The Hirschman book is a jewel. You know, it's just absolutely wonderful. So you should take a look at that. The standard book, you probably want to read the article that Larry was mentioning.
I'll find it.
Okay, so I just
over here.
Yes.
I'm not a theorist, so I tread with some trepidation, but I've always thought that what you want the model to be the minimum that you need to make the point you want to make, which is a bit different way of putting it than you just did.
Sure.
And so in thinking about the model that you just put out, I think it does a nice job of illustrating, you know, the value of an outside option and how that varies with certain aspects of the problem. If I were Lanny or other people,
yes,
I might be concerned that my sense is that they have a notion that there's good, there's sort of intrinsic goodness in network interactions that is absent in market interactions, because mm-hmm. of the fact that you are confronting people as people rather than objectifying them in the way that the market pushes you to do.
Yes.
And
so,
that's not in there. So
yes.
They might object to that.
This is exactly Sandel, too.
Yes.
Certainly.
Yes. So, yeah, I mean, as I said, these are long and, you know, very deep, in many ways very deep sort of waters, and long literature in deep water. So I, you know, your point is well taken. Having said that, I think this is what I was trying to also get across when I said that when I was reading Sandler and so on, I did think about relevance. And I think this is maybe a way that economists think about the problem. Maybe it reflects, you know, the way we think about the world. And so I take, you know, what you're saying about the intrinsic value of things, I think I'm taking very much the consequentialist, if you like, the welfare aspect. And I'm asking, you know, is there a welfare aspect of things in which, you know, these things actually, Sandel's argument makes sense, or they don't. But I think Larry would like to stop.
I have two minutes because I really want to say something about that.
Okay, so then I'll ask you to wait.
And that is that there is nothing in Moskalo, Winston, and Green that says that the classic model, right, of the utilitarian model that we all have known, come to love, or maybe hate in some ways, excludes things like values and social relations, right? So
it doesn't exclude anything.
Right, that's exactly
that's,
right.
That's part of the problem.
I'm thinking, well, it's not a problem, it's an opportunity.
Right.
So you know, I happened to be reading last night Ken Binmore's critique of, you know, the national, you know, the experiments in 15 primitive tribes around the world with the ultimatum game. You know, so you know that stuff, right? Peyton Young's comment on that, by the way, I just love. I asked Peyton what he thought of this research. He got this little smile on his face, and he said, "You know, what we learned is that all around the world, people play Nash equilibrium." but Binmore, you know, Binmore points out, right, that in all of the claims that they make about what's wrong with the, you know, the neoclassical paradigm because of this, he wanted to point out that these complaints are, they're complaining against the straw man because the kinds of things that they're complaining about is not the utilitarian framework, but what goes into it, right? And if you only assume, right, that you care about how much you consume, you're going to get some answer, some welfare answer. But there's no reason why you can't say that there's value to strong social relations and new social relations might get weaker. And so you're not forced into this kind of conclusion by the economic analyses that we do, which is contrary to the belief that many people in other social sciences hold. And that's why I want to make this point.
Sure. I hope that point is, Larry, you may want to make it again later in the day. That's an important point.
I'll make it as often as you want.
Okay.
All right,
so I think we're going to stop these other, So I'd just like you to, let me take a step back and just say that, I hope this was not too formal and too mathematical, but do come in the break if, you have concerns. Do feel free to alert me, if your reactions, and ask me questions during the break, but we'll have one more hour after the break. Thanks very much. I have about 49 slides. There is no way that I can cover 49 slides. I don't know how much time I have, but I probably have about 50 minutes. So there's no way that I can cover all the slides. So let me see. So because Larry raised some questions earlier on about models where you have, and also in the break, one of the students came to me and asked me the same question that Larry was saying, that there's some interest in models where you have games or you have choices and you also have network formation. So I'm going to present, I'm going to go through a model like that. So working backward from that means that I was planning to go through three models. So I'm going to drop model two. Okay. And so I'm going to talk a bit about model one, and then I'll talk about model three. And the idea of these lectures is to give you an introduction to network formation. So before I, get into the models, I think it's a good idea, for you, for example, to think about some of the networks we looked at. Maybe you want to think about Facebook. Now, I know that some of these networks are not allowed in China, or I don't know, is Facebook... What's the state of Facebook in China?
It's blocked. It seems to be blocked now, but I had a former student who was here 2 weeks ago and said she was using Facebook without a network, without a VPN. So it seems to come and go.
But then there must be a Chinese equivalent of Facebook. All I want to do is, so my objectives of this lecture, I think are to make you just think about networks that you live in, or you have, maybe you have Facebook or a Chinese equivalent of Facebook. Maybe you're on Twitter. It's one of the facts of life that people are quite happy to say I'm on Facebook, but they are very embarrassed to say they're on Twitter. I've lectured in different parts of the world when I ask people, are they on Facebook? This is the first time I'm lecturing in China, so you may not be on Facebook, but I was recently in Brazil, people just put up their hands, when I said Facebook. When I ask for Twitter, people get very quiet. So I don't know why that's the case. But anyway, that's
we know what Twitter means in Portuguese. No, I won't.
It may be dying. I think there are some reasons to believe that Twitter may be slowly vanishing, because most of the people are not active. I think 40% of Twitter account holders have never or almost never tweeted. I'm one of them. I've never tweeted. so
Then I shouldn't bother you anymore.
I'm sorry?
Then I shouldn't bother you anymore.
What can I say? So what I'd like you to do, the big takeaway that I would like from this is, I think I would like you to think about networks that you see around, that you may live in, or that you walk on by the roads, or the trains that you take, or the planes that you fly in. The World Wide Web, or Google, which is not allowed in China, but it's in Baidu, I think it's allowed in China. It probably works on similar principles. It's probably more efficient and better, than Google. But I want you to think about all these things as actually networks that are created by people, or by firms, or by countries. Okay? And I would like you to think about why is it that people create links? Why is it that people, people propose friendships to me, and I delete most of them. I actually am completely passive on Facebook. I'm a free rider. There are friends of mine who are there every day. They send, and it's great fun. I'm very, very grateful to them.
But Mona Smith, who's there every hour.
I would like you to think about why people are these networks. And at the same time, I would like you to ask, what do people do on these networks? Right? They go on to Facebook. They do things on Facebook. We were talking the other day about, tennis courts and golf courses, and nobody is on them. Well, because they're probably on Facebook. Right? So you might wonder, I have two teenage sons, and they're always gaming, they're doing something or the other on some game on the television. Now, probably because they're doing that, they're not doing other things. Right? They're not playing on the tennis court. They are playing football virtually, not actually kicking the ball. it sounds like a slightly silly sort of thing, but if you look at teenagers and you look at people, not just teenagers, in fact, I look at my colleagues, they're always on some electronic device. There is a sense in which, I think the texture of modern life is very different from what it was 20 years ago. In fact, I remember presenting some network formation work at Northwestern University in 1998. And I remember people coming to me and saying, what is this about? What is this supposed to be about? And I actually said, I made some vague noises, And now, people actually think, network formation is embedded in our ordinary lives. We are constantly following people. We are making friendships, and many of you may be on LinkedIn. People keep asking me to link with me on LinkedIn, etc. So I think, these are very ordinary activities now. So I want to just, I would like you to just think about the dynamics of these things, and I would like you to think about incentives, motivations for these things. Okay. And what I'll be talking about today is very specific, very formal models. And like all formal models, they make a lot of assumptions. They are very, hopefully very parsimonious, but they are very, specific in many ways. And so it's just a way to organize our thoughts about a very large scale phenomenon. So having, with all that background in mind, the key idea is, we want to think about structure. We want to think about network structure as arising out of choice. Now, this is, of course, a very extreme assumption. Sociologists believe you're born and to do what you're asked to do by your elders or by your cousins or your uncles and, your friends. That's how economists believe that you're born, you have some preferences, and those preferences may involve social relationships, but we, by and large, don't worry about them, and too much. At least we didn't until recently. And then we make choices. Okay. What we're doing here is we are making the social structure itself an object of choice. This is not as radical as it might sound, but the formal work is quite new. The other remark I would like to make is that the idea of graphs forming, networks forming, is not a new one. Mathematicians and others have looked at this problem of networks forming. They have typically looked at it without worrying about incentive, without worrying about human motivations. They have written down mathematical models of great beauty and elegance, but having rather abstract, non-human sort of motivations, and also therefore non-strategic structure. So it's that element of cost benefits and strategy, calculating what you're going to do, what I should do, this interaction, that's new in some of the work that's happened in economics in the last roughly 20 years. Okay, and I'm going to give you a first generation model to start with, and then I'll give you a newer, incarnation, a more up-to-date version. So I'm going to start, because I'm very short of time, I will look at the simplest model, and I'll just walk you through this model. So the model that we are most comfortable with, the most well-developed model in economics, is one where people make choices, and we can make these choices in an individual way, unilaterally. I go and buy some stuff, I form a link with you on Twitter, or I create a link with you on your, a hyperlink with you on your web page. This is something I can do, and I do unilaterally. These are the kinds of problems that we are particularly good at studying. Okay? And so that's going to be the spirit of this model. Okay? Each person, there's a bunch of us, and each of us can form a link with a subset of others. Okay? There's a cost to forming the links, and there are some rewards for forming these links. This could be informational rewards, it could be favors, it could be a variety of rewards. The key novelty here is that when I form a link with you, I can benefit from the links you have formed with other people. Okay, if you're a well-connected guy, you are well-informed, if I come to you, I can share some of that information. I can get some of that information easily. So I want to connect to people who are well-connected. Okay, that's going to be the straight and the kind of flavor of this model. Okay, so there are, the reason I want to write on this model is that it is a natural model to write down. It's just a very, you will see it's a very tractable model, and it is easy to analyze, and it says interesting, does interesting results. In terms of applications, it's a model that might fit some applications, but the main attraction of this model is that it allows us to think about linking and networks in a coherent way, and it allows us to look at some of the trade-offs that arise, some of the economic tensions in this problem, and also the dynamics in an industry. So this is a, again, all the references should be at the end of the slides, and the slides will be with you. I'll be giving, passing on the slides to Marie, and so you shouldn't, try and rush and write anything that's on the slides. You would have the slides. So this is a model where there are these players and they are choosing links with a subset, and that's the strategy. This is the strategy. Okay, this is person I, and she chooses a bunch of links with her group. And these are binary links. Very, very simple model. So each of these aspects of the model can be enriched, and have that indeed over time. This is a first generation model, 2000. So in the economics, one of the facts about sociological facts about economics is that when you write a paper, it gets published, you're very lucky, 4 years later. So we wrote this paper, in fact, many years before, but so it's a first generation model. So it's very, you'll see that it's very simple. So once I have the strategy profile, it naturally generates a directed graph. This is Mr. R, and she's formed a link with J, let's say with K and L. And similarly, J has formed a link with I and with K. K has formed a link with L. So these, this is the strategy, SI, SJ, and so forth. And you see that this profile of strategy, the strategy profile, generates a directed graph. By a directed graph, I just mean a graph in which the links are directed. They go from me to you, or from you to me. All right, so now I have this graph. And the simplest model I want to write is I want to think of each link as having a cost, C, some cost. And then I want to think about the information, okay? Think of Twitter, it's flowing. So I form a link, I'm following you. Larry says he's following me. Okay, so this is Larry, okay, he follows me, and I'm sure I'm following you. And so what does that mean? It means if I retweet, Larry gets to hear what I'm hearing from you. So there is this network flow of information along the path, along a directed path. So that's the simplest model. Okay, and you can now write down the payoffs, okay, of that game. Okay, and you can solve it using Nash equilibrium. Okay, it's the simplest thing. Okay, and I would urge you to try and do that. So what happens? So in that simple world, let's think about that world, because it's a very natural world to think about. And I want to link with people who are following lots of people. Because when I come to you and you're following lots of people, then I get to hear about everything just by following you. Okay. I don't want to be following, you know, James, who is really not following anyone. Because James is a great guy, but when I follow him, I just learn about inequality, you know. But I don't learn about anything else because he's not following anyone else.
We can learn about poverty too, but that's a different story.
Yes. So that's the kind of trade-off. Yeah, of course, James might be such a wonderful person to follow just by himself because there's heterogeneity. Some people are interesting, other people are boring. And so I might want to follow James and think this is a very interesting person. So in itself. So I want to take that into account, this heterogeneity.
So maybe he links to other people who are very valuable. They might help a lot of people, but they're very valuable.
Sure, so there is that issue, right? I mean, yeah, exactly. So I think you want to have those ideas in your mind. You're kind of very sophisticated and quick in seeing, you know, these issues that you have value and you have numbers of people. So now you want to write down this model and you want to ask, you start from some arbitrary network. So you think about the dynamics, you start from some network, people, I start following James, then I start following Larry, I start following you, and then I see that I'm actually getting some information, but maybe I'm not getting a lot of information. I look around and I locate other people and I start following them. And then similarly, all of you are also looking around and you're forming links. And this network is evolving. Okay, then this is how the dynamics of the network are. Okay, and you ask what happens to this network. Okay, so there, if you think about Twitter, you think about some network like that. People come into this world. Okay, people register, and they look up, and then they try and follow people. Sometimes they find these people are very boring, so they delete the link. Okay, and. Because they keep saying, tweeting very silly things, and it's a pain, so they delete the link. So now you ask, you know, what happens to this network over time? Okay, you want to ask what's the topology of this network. You want to ask what's the information flow of this network. Okay, you want to ask what's the value of being on Twitter. So there are a lot of people who are on Twitter. In fact, they use Twitter as an advertising platform. So there's a body of work, in fact, studying Twitter, the empirical properties of Twitter over time. In fact, some colleagues of Larry's at Cornell, some computer science colleagues, in fact, have done some work on looking at Twitter. Okay, and there are other people, as you can imagine, it's a very, very rich network, dynamically, you know, very evolved, and sort of very dynamically rich. Interesting network, you can study its properties. And recently, just this year, someone actually tried to write down a formal model, a strategic model of link formation on Twitter. Okay, and you can read it. I don't remember the name of the author, but if you come to me, just actually go online and write down network formation on Twitter, and you will get this paper. Okay. So this model actually does what you were saying. It has heterogeneity, it has linking costs, it has this indirect retweeting. And it asks, what is the structure of the network? Okay. So does anyone have some ideas about Twitter? What do you think it looks like? Or I don't know, what is the Chinese equivalent of Twitter? Is there a Chinese equivalent?
We have a very similar app named Weibo.
So you can study the properties, and you can ask, step back, and you can ask, why do people go there, who goes there, and what do they do? And then you can ask, you know, what kind of network is going to form, and then you can look at the actual properties of the network. And you can see that your model is a good model. So that's a kind of hot experiment that you might want to do. This is not what I'll be doing in the lecture in the next 15, 20 minutes, but that's just a thought experiment. And in the paper, in fact, we solved that model. Okay. We solved that model, and it turns out actually to be quite a hard problem to work out, but you can read the paper, and it is easily available online, and that model is used to then extend and work with heterogeneous pairs and so on. Okay. But what I'm going to do now is look at a slightly, if you like, a modification of the model. And the modification I'm going to have is going to have the following flavor. When I form a link with you, I get information from you, but you also get information from me. So the idea is, again, this is a modeling, it's a modeling idea. It's probably not a very good, it's not a good descriptor of anything in the world out there, but you will see that it's actually quite a useful modification because it allows us to get a lot of intuitions. So here's the idea. When I form a link with you, I can actually get information from you, but you can also get information from me. That's the idea here, the last bullet point here. Okay, so I now take this network and I define the closure of this. Okay, what does it mean to define the closure? As long as there's a link here, I define an undirected version of this graph. Okay. So that's the undirected version, and that's how the benefits are defined. So now we have this function phi. We had this earlier in the first part of the lecture, but here's another function. What does it say? It says that my payoff as person I is going to depend on the number of people I access in this network, okay, directly or indirectly, and the number of links I form. That's the number of links I create. And we want the payoff to be increasing in the number of people you access and to be falling in the number of links you create. That's the assumption we want to make. Now we want to ask, what's the network that forms? With the simple, we have the pairs, we have these strategies, we have the payoffs, what's the equilibrium? So here's a very simple result. And essentially, what does it say? It says that the network is connected. Okay. What does that mean? It means for every person I, there is a path for every other person G. And the intuition there is very simple. If you are sitting in some group connected up, that means you're forming links to connect up. If I come in, my payoff is even larger because I'm going to link with this whole group, whereas you're sitting there, you have yourself and the rest of the group. So if you are happy with that group, I would be even happier to join the group. So I can't have two islands. So the people on one island are happy to be connected. A member of another island will always be even happier to connect with this island. So you're going to have connected. Okay. And because there is no, all I care about is whether I have a path for you. I don't care about the length of the path. I don't have any incentive to have close by I'm happy to have a long path. So in other words, I don't need to have any cycles. So the network is minimally connected. There are no cycles. So it's a very first step sort of result. And here are some examples. Very simple. This is small, very small number of people, four people, five people. These are minimal networks. They have no cycles. That's the property of the minimal networks. So there are lines, there are some hub-spoke networks. These are networks in which the center pays for the links. These are networks in which the periphery or the spokes pay for the links. And so you can, you know, there's a large set of minimally connected networks. Now you can ask which of these is more robust. And the basic intuition is that in applications like information networks, you don't want to be very far apart because information decays as it travels along the network. So that's the idea that is now captured in this slide. It's saying here that the payoff depends on the distance from other people. So these are the people you access. There is some discount, some decay parameter delta, and the further out you are, the lower your payoff is. That's the basic idea. So once you have this decay parameter, now whether you want to link with people directly or indirectly depends on the cost. If the costs are very small, then I want to be close to everyone. But if the costs are large, I'm happy to have long distance with some people. So that's sort of the basic idea here is if C is very small, then you want to have a complete network. You want to be linked with everyone directly. And if C is very large, then you only want to be linked with people if they are linked with many people. So that's the idea here. Okay. So here's a theorem. It's quite a sharp result, and let's just try and understand what the result is. This is saying that when delta is close to 1, so that means there's very little decay, but there is some decay, and the cost of linking is reasonable. It's not very large, but it could be large. It's sort of smaller than the size of the population, but it's larger than linking to one single person. I don't want to link with you. I don't want to link with James if he's all by himself, but if James is linked to many people, then I'm happy to connect to him. So what happens now is, let's go back and look at this network here. Okay, so here's an intuition. Since delta is close to 1, there's very little decay, the network should not have cycles. But if there are no cycles, then there are leaves. A leaf in a network is someone like this person here, who has just a single link. That's a leaf in a network. So since the network has no cycles, it must be having people who are sitting at the edge of the network. That's just an implication of not having cycles. If you're sitting at the edge of the network, let's look at, for example, this person here, Mr. 8. Mr. 8 is, delta is less than 1, which means distances matter. They don't matter greatly, but they matter. So the idea is that 8, rather than linking with 2, would delete the link with 2 and instead link with 1, and she's going to be closer to many more people. Okay, so this is basically the idea that rather than linking with someone who's linked to the center of the world, I might as well link with the center of the world. It would be quicker to get there. I'd be less distant. That pressure is the heart of the argument here. Okay. As the decay exists, there's a pressure on the leaves to go towards the center. There's a pressure to cut down distances. And that leads to everyone going towards a hub. And in particular, then, it leads to a network like this. Yes, Larry.
So I just want to point out, to make a link back to my lecture of Monday, that exactly the networks we're talking about here, do you remember the old lady, the one who was not my wife, Lois Flexenberg? This is that network, right? because it is minimizing distance, right? In exactly the way that Sanjeev is describing, that is her social goal. And that is why, as I mentioned, this seems to be the way that many of the outcomes in the Milgram experiments were realized, that there was a central person from whom everything went in several of the runs that he did, including some that he didn't report on.
Yeah, but is this argument? So this is a. So as I said, so we take a step back. We see that this is a very stylized model of network formation. There's no heterogeneity. There are no dynamics. I'm just solving a one-shot game. And you know, the linking is slightly artificial, but I'm able to get that. You know. In prior eye, when I started thinking about this, in fact, it was not clear at all what will happen. It is a rather hard problem. When n is 100 or 200, you're already looking at a vast collection of networks. Okay, so the fact that there is only one non-empty equilibrium network is quite striking. Okay. You could ask, supposing you start from some arbitrary network, will you converge to this network? Or will the network cycle and would it sort of go eternally somewhere, you know, so it'd be all over the place, or would it converge to this? How quickly would it converge to this network? So what are the dynamics of this network? So in this paper, we also looked at the dynamics. I won't have time to talk about that, but that's a key feature of a model like this, that since it's simple enough, you can address lots of questions that are first order and try and build some intuition about what are the key forces at work. So now, because we are in a summer school about inequality, notice that what's happening with the, so we've got to this hub spoke type of network where the spokes are linking with the hub. So what about the inequality? Well, you know, approximately, very roughly speaking, the payoff to the center are n minus t, because she connects to it, she's linked directly to everyone, then that's close to one. So her payoffs are approximately n. And the payoffs to everyone else are n minus c. So the inequality is going to depend on the cost c. If c is large, there's lots of inequality. If c is small, there's very little inequality. So the network is actually very unequal. So if you go back and you check, you will see that this is the kind of network. If you have thousands of people sitting here, then you know the network is very unequal. The degree inequality is very great. Okay, it's but you know, payoff inequality depends on the cost. Okay, so there's a very nice experiment in the lab with this model. Okay, so let me say two words about laboratory experiments. I don't know if anyone else is going to talk about lab experiments in the summer school, but I think yesterday Scott talked about RCTs. Did he talk about?
He didn't talk about lab experiments.
He's mainly field experiments.
Right. So yesterday you heard a lot about RCTs. So you could do RCTs in a lab, in a computer lab, and then this is the kind of experiment that this paper is about. So what happens, the takeaway message, okay, from this experiment, and more generally actually other experiments in this field, is that when networks are very unequal and they have unequal payoffs, then when you run these games, people are willing to tolerate unequal networks when their payoff advantages are large. Okay, but if the payoff advantages to having these unequal networks are not that large, then they try and stay away from the unequal networks. Okay, so maybe this is going to resonate with James. The idea here is that if you go back here, you see that there are these inequalities. Okay, so I don't really want you to be the center, because if you are the center, you're going to earn a lot more than me. Okay, and that I may not want. In fact, I want to be the center myself. So there could be competition to be the center. Okay. But if you are very attractive, if James is just so valuable, then I may be willing to pay him to link with him. I know that we're all of them linked with him. He earns much more than us. But because he's so valuable, I may be willing to, accommodate that. Okay, that's the takeaway message from this experiment. If linking to one player is more worthwhile than linking to others, then you get these hubs arising. So inequality is more likely to go if there are large payoff gains.
So I'm going to skip this. So this second model was about what happens when I know that being central in a network gives me a lot of rents, gives me a lot of payoffs, then I want to create links to become central in the network. And you want to prevent me from being central in the network. And so you create links to go around me in the network. So what happens in that sort of a network formation story? So this sounds a little abstract and it sounds a little, far-fetched. But if you think about banks, you think about trading, intermediaries, people are constantly trying to sit in between buyers and sellers and make intermediary rents. But then buyers and sellers are trying to find alternative routes to reduce the rents. Okay, so that's the spirit of this paper, and I don't have time to, I'm almost out of time, so I won't talk about this, but it's in the slides, and you might want to look at it. And so this paper is, of course, very much, recently there's been a lot of interest in financial networks. And you can use that sort of model to understand financial network data, essentially. Financial networks often have a core periphery structure where the core is functioning as an intermediary for the rest of the system and making, actually having a lot of rents out of that. So you can actually use that sort of model to study financial networks. Okay. So I have another 10 minutes, so.
Well, five. Yeah, it's 1 o'clock now. We have to stop. We have to start again at 2.
Okay.
You can take them.
All right. So I wanted to placate you because you were saying there are no models where you have action in games. Okay. So this is. And I think a student came by. I think you came by, right? And asked me in the break. That most of the papers or networks either have people playing on a fixed network or they have a pure network formation story. They rarely have both, and they rarely have, the things going on. Okay.
We should mention, and I'll give you the time back to this, is that there are a large number of random graph models that people like Thomas Snyder's estimate that actually jointly determine edges and actions on those, right?
Yeah,
so all that sociological literature, and Matt Jackson commits this sin too.
I leave it at that.
I can't thank you.
Okay, so what I want to do is, so I want to take the network formation model I had earlier. Okay, so just to remind you, it's at the end of 3 hours, and I'm sure you're satiated and fed up. But this is the model. Okay. This is a model where we have some information and I link with you. What I want to do now is I want you to also choose information. Okay? I link with you, but I also read the newspapers. Okay. So, alright, so I also read the newspapers, maybe I talk to other people, etc., but I read the newspapers and I also tweet, okay, using the newspapers. So I'm doing two things, linking and reading the newspapers. All right. So this is the model. So this is a very. I won't have time. Maybe I'm not. Maybe I don't have time. So this is a very old literature in sociology, and it's about the nature of social communication in communities, and these are the empirical patterns, and in fact, there's a lot of more recent work on online social community, which has very similar. There is a core group of people who everyone talks to, and these are highly connected, so it's a core periphery network. And the guys in the core are different, but it's only slightly different from other people. Okay. So somehow these slight differences make for a very different location in the network.
question is, why are these people in the core gathering so much information? And why are the others basically just linking with these people? How do you explain that? Okay, so, so here's the model. So it's a model exactly like the gate network formation model we had earlier. But now I have a second strategic variable. I have the network linking, and I have reading the newspapers or some action X, which is some real number. Okay, I can do a lot of it or I can do a little of it. So I do both actions. Some activity or problem to the network, if you like, and some linking activity. So this is the strategy. And so now I have the strategy profile, and I can again look for the equilibrium. I can basically look what's going to be happening in this network. So this is a payoff function. Remember, in the earlier model, I had this linking cost, and I had the reward from the network. Now I have an additional action cost. This is how much I read newspapers. And the rest is just, you know, just to make the model tractable. F is some increasing K function. That means that this X activity is a strategic substitute. So this model, the pure action model, we have taken from a paper by Brummel and Cranton, which actually builds on work by Larry and his co-authors on public goods, private provision of public goods. Okay, so it's very simple, much simpler variant of Larry's work, but in a network setting, in a network formation setting. All right, so what's going to happen? Again, I'm going to do something very simple. I'm just going to look for action equilibrium. Okay, nothing, there's no conceptual innovation here, and I'm just going to apply this. And what are we going to learn? Okay. So here are the networks that we are going to be particularly interested in. So what's going on here is, these are core periphery networks. But the core is doing all the information acquisition. These are the guys who are doing large X. And the white guys are basically forming links with these black guys. And they are doing no information acquisition. They are just linking and finding out everything about the world from these black guys. So the question is, what is the size of the black population relative to this whole population? And the law of the few is a statement about the relative size of this active group. This is very small. Okay, the data that these people so surely just looked at is about 20% of the population. But in more recent online communities, it could be 4 or 5% of the population does all the active advising. Everyone else is just asking questions. You go to forums, online forums, and you ask a question, you will see the same people answering all the questions. Those are the guys sitting here. Okay, so the question is, I have, you know, what happens in this game? And the theorem is, okay, there's going to be lots of things happening in this paper, but this is the theorem. The main theorem is a law of the few, and what does it say? It says that if the cost of linking K is smaller than the cost of acquiring information that I would acquire if I were alone in the world. Okay. That's a reasonable assumption. That's the only interesting case. If I were alone in the world, I would acquire y hat. That would cost me c times y hat. The cost of linking with you should be less than that. Otherwise, I would never link with you. Right. So this is the only interesting case. In every equilibrium, you have the law of the few. In particular, it means that you have a core periphery network. The core acquires information, the periphery acquires no information. And the ratio of people who acquire information, this is this number of people, I star, these are people buying information, X active. Now the fraction of the number of people, that goes to zero and then gets large. So that's the theory. Okay, so I don't have time to go through the proof. So let me just pause and say a few words about this. What this paper does is it takes a it shows the value of writing down very parsimonious, simple models of linking. When you write down really simple models of linking, you can then bring in complications that you're interested in, like activity, like in this case, the public good activity. If you had a much more complicated linking model, there was no hope you would be able to solve, you know, you would be able to solve the model when you introduced some interesting economics. So this is more generally true. A lot of the progress in recent years on network formation has been made by, in fact, simplifying the linking even more, in fact, getting rid of all strategic elements, just making it very simple cost benefit, very simple boundedly rational linking. Okay. Why? Because then you can introduce a lot more economics, interesting economics, if you like, into the model and still keep it attractive. Okay. But this gives you a flavor of what are the attractions for keeping the linking rich, but at the same time, very simple. Okay. And you can sort of try and get at phenomenon that, you know, that people want to understand. Okay, so here's another feature of this model. Remember that when I was talking about, you know, what's the law of the few, the third bullet point was this observation, that if you measure the education, the age, the gender of these poor people, in fact, they're not very different from people who are at the periphery. You can imagine that marketing firms would be very interested to know who these people are at the core, right? These are the people they really would love to know because they can target these people. Okay. So we know from all the empirical work, they're different, but not very different. So that motivates this idea here that we want to look at people who are slightly different than the other people. And what happens if you do that? So I'm going to look at a world where some people have a lower cost of buying information. Some people just love to buy information more than other people. Okay, that's the only modification I'm making. And then you get a very simple theorem. It says that the guy who has a lower cost is always going to be the hub person. Everyone else is just going to form a link with them. Okay. And so you get this. These are the kinds of equilibria you get. You have the low-cost guy. There's a unique low-cost guy. He's a unique hub. Everyone else just links with this person. And what you see in these equilibria is that the hub does most of the information acquisition. So in this case, in fact, the hub does, you know, the peripheral guys also buy some information. And in this case, they buy no information at all. The hub does all the information acquisition. But these are this is the kind of range of outcomes you can have. And so you get this very sharp characterization. And you get bounds on how much information the center acquires and how much information the periphery there is acquired. So I didn't have time to go through the arguments, but I hope I showed you. You can take a network formation problem, a linking game, add on an action, a game, a public good game, and then study the things together. And when you do that together, you can explain things that, you know, this is an old empirical regularity. This law of the few goes back at least to the 1950s, and you can write down a model that you know, gives you some intuitions as to why the world would exhibit the law. And the references here, there's a full set of references. I think most of them are available online. And I would, you know, urge you to take a look at them. But this particular model that I've talked about has also been studied in a laboratory setting. People have tried to understand whether these networks form. Law of the few kind of networks, where you have this complicated game, because it's a very complicated game. You're choosing X and you're choosing the network, and it's very unclear anything like this law of the few will obtain. And again, there's lots of inequality in these networks. In fact, the poor guys are providing lots of public goods. Okay, so there's a very lively interest in experiments on these games. And now, of course, people are also doing field experiments in these kinds of games. And I'll leave you with that. I'm